The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. We gather together as a parish family on this beautiful autumn day to give praise and thanks to God for God's many, many blessings in all those ways. May God continue to show his love for us. We gather around our healing table to be nourished on the very presence of Jesus Christ so that we might be empowered to go forth from this place, to be Christ's presence, to be Christ's body, to be Christ's church for one another and for our world. As we gather together, we welcome all our visitors. We are delighted to be with us. We hope that you feel very welcome, very much at home here at St. Mary's, and you're able to join us all. We welcome in a special way our guests of other faith traditions who honor us with your presence. Remind you that under this roof, we are all a family, children of the same God, sisters and brothers to one another. And so now, as God's children, let us pause for a moment to call to mind our sinfulness, and let us ask God for forgiveness. Lord Jesus, your love for us is not greater than we could ever imagine or ever hope for. Lord, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you call us to love one another. Christ, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you feed us with your body and with your blood to nourish us on our journey. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sin, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. O God, who manifest your mighty power above all by pardoning and showing mercy, bestow, we pray, your grace abundantly upon us, and may these hastened, may those hastening to attain your promises, heirs to the treasure of heaven. For our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you, the youth of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen. May the children come forth for the children's liturgy of the word.
Amen. Zion. Lying upon beds of ivory, stretched comfortably on their couches, they eat, lambs taken from the flock and calves from the stall, improvising to the music of the flock. Like David, they devise their own accompaniment. They drink wine from bowls and anoint themselves with the best oils. Yet they are not being ill by the collapse of Joseph. Therefore, now they shall be the first to go into exile, and their wanton revelry shall be done away with. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The responsorial psalm is on page 117.
Jesus said to the Pharisees, "There was a rich man who dressed in purple garments and fine linen, and dined sumptuously each day. And lying in his door was a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, who would gladly have eaten his fill of the scraps that fell from the rich man's table. Dogs even used to come and lick his sores. But the poor man died. He was carried away by the angels to the bosom of Abraham. The rich man also died and was buried. And from the nether world, where he was in torment, he raised his eyes and saw Abraham far off and Lazarus at his side. And he cried out, 'Father Abraham, have pity on me. Send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am suffering torment in these flames.' Abraham replied, 'My child, remember that you received what was good during your lifetime, while Lazarus likewise received what was bad. And now he is comforted here, whereas you are tormented. Moreover, between us and you, a great chasm is established to prevent anyone from crossing who might wish to go from our side to yours, or from your side to ours.' He said, 'Then I may, Father, send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, so that he may warn them, lest they too come to this place of torment.' But Abraham replied, 'They have Moses and the prophets. Let them listen to them.' He said, 'Oh no, Father Abraham, but if someone from the dead goes to them, they will repent.' And Abraham said, 'If they will not listen to Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded if someone should rise from the dead.'" The Gospel of the Lord. As we begin a new year, I think it's a good time to share with you where we have been as a parish family, where we're at, and with God's help, where we're going. My goal since becoming pastor of St. Mary's 10 years ago was to build upon a rich tradition that is St. Mary's. We have very, very strong roots. We stand on the shoulders of giants in the faith. Our mothers and fathers, grandmothers and grandfathers laid a great foundation for us to build upon. And my goal has always been to strengthen us as a Eucharistic community, a family centered around that table. I think our recent history for all of us can be divided into three parts: pre-COVID, COVID lockdown, and living with COVID as our new reality. In the months leading to the sudden COVID shutdown, we were at a real high. In the fall, we celebrated my 40th anniversary. And it was always a goal of mine that this celebration be not only about me, but it be a celebration of ministry and a celebration of St. Mary's as a parish family. It was amazing. So many people coming together, working together, getting to know each other, forming community. It was such a great experience of what parish is meant to be. In the midwinter, we put out a notice calling people and inviting people, gathering parishioners who are willing to run a host of parish events. And to our surprise, that Tuesday night, the gathering room was filled to the brim with over 100 people. Now, in St. Mary's tradition, I'm sure it helped that we served wine and cheese. And by the second glass of wine, we had at least 10 sheets filled with names for 10 different events that people were going to run for the year. That was a tremendous high of bringing people together. In early March, we had a very successful parish mission. We came together as a community and were inspired by God's word. A week later, the bottom fell out. We, like everyone else and everything else, had to close. And so we needed to completely reinvent ourselves. And the goal continued to be to keep us connected to each other and the Eucharist, and to maintain our relationship with our kids and nurture them in the faith. Everything we did as a parish family, we did to accomplish that goal. It was a whole new world. A whole new world for so many of us. And as you know, many of you know that I'm a Facebook person, and every day you get your memories. And I get my memories from the last 2 years. I have to say sometimes when I look at the pictures from the last 2 years, I get a little post-stress disorder. Zoom meetings, Zoom religious education classes held outside under the tents, tents falling down, tents breaking, tents put up again, poles replaced, masks outside, masks online, 5 p.m. mass projected on the side of the church. When it got really cold, we did something so we got on a radio station so that people could keep their doors closed and they could still hear the mass. We had outside hospitality. One of the coldest masses I ever celebrated was on Ash Wednesday in the middle of winter outside. We had outside hospitality. We had driver blessings. We distributed Eucharist distributed to cars in the parking lot. We had a drive-by nativity. Anything and everything we could do to keep us connected around that table as a family. Personally, the hardest time for me was celebrating Holy Week that year. Holy Week is by far my favorite time of the year. It is central to our faith and so inspiring. For the year of lockdown, we celebrated the beautiful, beautiful liturgies of Holy Week alone. It was me, a camera person, a lector, and a cantor. And what made it even more difficult is that we had to record it ahead of time so that we could make it available on the day, which meant that we recorded Easter Sunday on Good Friday. Talk about being all fouled up and all screwed up. But we knew it needed to happen in order for us to keep connected to our tradition, to the Eucharist, to who we are. And together we made it work. Financially, with God's help, we survived. Because we obtained the PPP, Paycheck Protection Program, loan and grant, and the generosity of several families who gave large one-time gifts to get us through. That was a lifesaver. More people enrolling with online giving, we share and contributing directly to the bank, helped us to get through those slumps. And we always have slumps because it's winter, there's summer, and so the crowd comes down, and when the crowd goes down, the collection goes down. If you have a snowstorm, you have nothing. And so people begin to give in an organized way through online giving and contribute to the bank, help to level things that we could survive. And even though that was true, we needed to cut back. We eliminated a full-time pastoral position. We were asked to open up again by the bishop with absolutely no preparation. And so once again, we had to scramble. We had to do what we needed to do. We had to do something to get it done. And the goal was to bring us back together safely. Quickly, we had to order find sanitation supplies, masks, tape. Because remember, we sanitized hands as people come in the church, and we sanitized them again as they came up to communion. We blocked off pews. We sanitized the church between every mass. That's why we had to stagger our services so that the church could be sanitized. We put lines on the carpet to maintain distance, to ensure safety for people. Our goal has always been to bring us together, because Catholicism is a faith that gathers. You cannot do it alone. It requires coming together. It's a faith that gathers. We need to be a part of each other. Since that time, we have done everything we can to welcome our families back. This past year, we planned a number of events designed to bring us back together in a non-threatening way. These events were chaired by parishioners. If you remember, we had spaghetti supper, we had entertainment by our magician, Steve Charette, who entertained not only our kids, but everyone. We had a string concert put on by my friends, the Panettis, with a friend of theirs. We had the Son of the Pastor pizza night, where kids and adults came with any questions they wanted to ask me. And I have to say that our kids came with such wonderful, wonderful, thought-out questions. They needed to stump me, and they did stump me a time and time again. I had to tell them, I had to look it up, because I didn't know the answer. We had St. Patrick's party with green beer. And at the end of the year, we had a giant outside holdout, which is simply magnificent. There were so many people there of all ages, and it was put on by parishioners. Many of them have not been involved in the church for a long time. Our message has always been, come back. We miss you. We need you. It is only together. We have done outreach through lockdown, through individual phone calls, through individual personal messages, through individual text, using Facebook, and whatever else you can tell me about to contact people through social media. Thanks to your generosity, to Legacy Pope, during the last 2 years, we accomplished some major capital improvements. I would have liked a little distance between turning off the air conditioning and putting on the heat. But Mother Nature really didn't cooperate with that. But I was very happy that we had the ability to do that, because in the past, we didn't have air conditioning and we couldn't count on the heat. And so thanks to installing a beautiful new HVAC system, we now are warm in the winter and cool in the summer. We put acoustical pianos and baffles to improve the sound in the hall. We could not have done those events that we did last year if that had not been done. It has completely changed the room in terms of acoustics and also in terms of aesthetics. And I could never imagine that we could have a violin concert in our hall. It would have been just too impossible to hear. But thanks to the ingenuity of our committee, who really did their jobs of doing the best, we got rid of many, many barrels and buckets because we have a new roof. All of you south of Mass with these little dump, that's taken care of. We were able to demolish the barn foundation has been laid for a new structure to house our, what we need to be house, our supplies. We replaced the stairs in the rectory, and we have these wonderful railings that help our people to get in and out of the sanctuary. Water in our church basement and water in our rectory basement has been an ongoing process. Problem. I mean, many days you needed hip boots, you know, to go for the basement. And, you know, when you have water in the basement, it leads to other problems. Thankfully, you know, we were able to waterproof the basement of the hall and waterproof the basement of the rectory. And so we've accomplished a lot together because of your generosity and because of your sacrifice. But we're presented with some big challenges as we move ahead. And the biggest challenge for me, and the most difficult for me, is bringing people back to church. Bringing people back to church. The numbers attending Mass is way down than before COVID, and that breaks my heart. The second thing is, we're still looking to fill three positions: a business manager, a pastoral associate, and a part-time janitor. Quite honestly, there are just not enough hands to make it work. We are really, really struggling. Financially, our income was down substantially this year from last year, and it was down last year from the year before. The reality is, over the last 10 years, many of our donors have gone to God. And many have moved away. And they're now being replaced with people who are as generous as them. That presents a real challenge to us. We can only meet these challenges together. And isn't that what families do? Isn't that what families do? We pool our resources, and I've never been in a place that has so many resources. We have such talented people. We need to tap into each other's talents to make it work together. We have formed a new ministry, Strengthening Our Parish Family, chaired by Patty and Jim Hurley. The first meeting of this core group will take place this Wednesday. This will help us to reach out to different groups, have different events, to bring people in, to help people to develop their time, their talent, and treasure. I'm grateful for all of you who continue to invite. That is so, so important. Continue to invite and make people feel welcome here. I'm grateful to those parishioners who have stepped forward to fill in some of our gaps. We need more helping. And thirdly, I'm also grateful to those who have increased their financial support of the parish, to those who have enrolled in automated giving and giving through their bank. And personally, if you were to choose giving through your bank, it is a better option for us. Because when you give through automated giving, they're a company, and so they charge a percentage that we lose off your offering. So giving through the bank is the best thing. I also ask you to consider a legacy gift by remembering St. Mary's in your will. I know we're concerned about making money to our family and friends and making sure everybody is okay. But what we're asking is that when you're making your will, when you're planning your estate, that you make St. Mary's a line item. So that what is good here continues after you have gone. You know, our Protestant brothers and sisters got the hang of this a long time ago. So many of the Protestant churches are endowed because they have that kind of thing. You know, most Catholic churches, you know what their endowment is? Nothing. So if you can do that, that will be helpful as we move into the future. Since its founding 138 years ago in 1884, St. Mary's has faithfully served the Holy Community. And we will continue to do so together. 132 years ago, this beautiful church was built by immigrants working in the mills. They made tremendous sacrifices that we would worship 132 years later in this beautiful building. We stand on the shoulders of our giants who given us a tremendous legacy and example. But every day, in working with you, I work with giants who are so generous in sharing their time and talents and treasure. So many of our parish really not only talk the talk, but walk the walk. And so as we gather around our family table, St. Mary's will continue to be the classy, energetic, spirit-filled place that it has always been, because together we will do it with each other.
Especially pray for Nairobi Kamau, Arthur Sharpenham, Dave Ellis, Matt silence of our hearts and those prayers and people who are written in our book of intentions and never forgotten by God. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. I'd like to join with me in praying our scripture prayer, which will be found at the back of the music issue. My church is composed of people like me. I what it is. It'll be friendly if I am. It feels to be filled if I help build it. It is great work if I work. Make generous gifts to many causes if I am a generous giver. It'll bring other people into this worship and fellowship if I invite and bring them. It'll be a church of loyalty and love, a fullness of faith, and a church with a noble spirit. If I make what it is and deal with these same things. Therefore, without God, I shall dedicate myself to the task of being all the things that I want my church to be. Amen.
For our minister, the preparation of gifts, in number 481, what wondrous love is this? Number 481. My sisters and brothers, that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, our ever-loving Father.
Loving God, for the many, many gifts you bless us with, we give back to you these very simple gifts of bread and wine. We ask you for the power of your Spirit to change them for us into the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, who is Lord forever and ever. My friends, the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We thank you, God our Father. You made us to live for you and for each other. We can sing and speak to one another, become friends and share our joys and our sorrows. And so, Father, we gladly thank you with everyone who believes you, with the angels and saints to rejoice and praise you as together we acclaim.
Strength to please you more and more.
Lord our God, remember Francis, our Pope, Robert, our Bishop, the Bishops, and all your people. Help all who follow Jesus work for peace and justice and bring happiness to us. Bring us at last, together with Mary, the Mother of God, and all the saints, to live with you and to be one with Christ in heaven. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in your name shall the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Jesus, who takes with us into a blessed cup of the supper of the Lord. So that its affection, not our own desires, may always prevail within us. We ask this through Christ our Lord. We'd like to continue our celebration by joining us for coffee and donuts in the gathering room after Mass. In last week's bulletin, there was a financial report for the last 2 years for St. Mary's. There was on that table. Our parishioner and accountant, Paul Clark, will be available in the gathering room if you have any questions about that financial report. This week is a great week, one of my favorite weeks of the whole year. I have a lot of favorite weeks, but it's one of my favorite weeks because we have orientation for first grade. So if we have any first graders here, we are so looking forward to meeting you and being with you on Monday and Tuesday. We're going to have a great time together. On Saturday, October 1st, at 4:30, our 4:30 Mass will be a Mass of healing with the sacrament of the sick. And so we invite anybody who wishes to receive that sacrament to come and to invite other people. Anybody who feels in need of healing in any way in their life is invited to join us for that. Also, the Holden Hunger Park Walk will take place on Sunday, October 16th. There are sheets in the back. There are envelopes for walkers. This is a place to make donations. This is a very worthy cause because it helps hungry people in our area. My friends, the Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I'm ascending, let us go in peace.
Our recessional hymn is number 378, Lord, You Give the Great Commission, number 378.